how do I write a good research paper? How do I improve my academic writing skills? What can I do to increase my chances in a job interview? How do I curate the best resume for my dream job?
Ever since the beginning of Christ deemed to be university, need has been felt to bridge the gap between the seekers of knowledge and the source. For that, Christ deemed to be university, through the Center of Academic and Professional Support, CAPS, brings you India's first professional online writing lab, providing students with opportunities for self-learning at their own pace. We aim to offer expert consultation and peer interaction opportunities to all Christites at free of cost. Our one-on-one interactive sessions, online tests, and digital certificates adds on to a better learning experience for the users. At Christ Online Writing Lab, we provide assistance at all times to our diverse audience and help them to enrich their professional and academic skills. Some of the courses that we offer are appearing for a job interview, resume writing, out of note taking, introduction to professional communication, research writing, and academic writing. In contemporary times, accessibility is the key to education. It is the only way that allows us to tap into everyone's potential. With the advent of digital medium, education is now available to everyone who wants to learn. This is our contribution to the history of Indian digital education. Christ Online Writing Lab.
Hello, this is a course on art of photography. I'm pretty much sure that you're not able to see me at all. It's mainly because there's no light. Well, let me put on the light. Still, you're not able to see me properly. Now, the light is too much. You all know that in the night, if you look at the sky, and if there's no stars and there's no moon, you won't be able to see anything. It'll be just as if you have closed your eyes. You'll be completely blind. But at the same time, if you're looking at the sun, still the same problem, but in a different. It's just that you'll be blinded with light. You still won't be able to see anything clearly. If you look away from the sun, you'll still may not be able to see anything much for some time because your eyes are blinded by light. Light, light, light. Now, let me make some changes. I'll make the adjustments so that you can see me properly. Right? There I am. Now let me introduce myself. I am Beni Vishwanath. I'll be taking you through the basics of photography. Since this is the basics, I'm not going to get into the details of it, but just the basic thing so that anyone can get into photography. I'm pretty much sure that all of you had been taking photographs for pretty long time, but at times you might be wondering what is going wrong with your photographs. Sometimes it'll come out amazingly well and many people will say, wow. Let me take you through a few photographs. So here are some photographs that I've taken. This is using mobile phone. If you look at it, it's okay. This is also fine, but when it comes here, if you notice here, you're not even able to see the person. It's pretty dark. Right? And here too, if you notice this, you can see the quality over here. It's not a good quality. Right? This is something which I've got from somewhere else. This is another one. Now, here again, you can see that the quality is not that great. Here again, it's an indoor shot taken in a mobile. using mobiles or whatever, you can take a lot of photos, but few will be good. Now, how can you make it better? That is what drove you to this particular course. How can you make better photographs? Now, I would say to make better photographs, first of all, you should be a better photographer. Now, what does it make a better photographer? There are a few things that you have to keep in mind. First is observation. See, everyone sees things around, but a good photographer notices things. They observe. It is something which others may not even notice. You should have a keen observation. And this leads to the next one, that is patience. At times you require a lot of patience, without which you will end up with mediocre photographs. I'll get into the details later. For time being, I'll just leave it as it is. Now let's get into good photographs. What's a good photograph? That is something which you need to think about. Now, obviously, when you thought of this course, you would have had in your mind that you need to get better photographs. That is where you came over here. Now, if you have to decide what is a good photograph, there are a lot of criteria. So one thing is creativity is what I would say. At the same time, it can be just a natural one. Of course, if it's an event or something like that, there's nothing much creative about it. And there's something called timing. That is very important. So when you blend these two, or at least one of these is there, then I guess you can make a better photograph. So what about creativity? Creativity is something like, I'll always say that I can teach a lot of things, but not creativity, because it's personal. It has to come from within. I always say that creativity is something that you think beyond what others think or do, beyond what others do. But you have to keep in mind that that doesn't mean that you have to walk upside down. It's different. You are doing things different. You are thinking different. And that is what reflects. Now, when it comes to timing, some photographs, when there is no creativity involved, timing is very important. Because it's all moments which will never come again. It can be an event, for example. So when you are covering an event, or maybe like a child, you know, the expressions that you're going to get, that nick of time. If you notice, many of the greatest photographers across the world who have even received awards, if you notice, at times there'll be no much creativity, but that particular moment that they have captured, that is very important, right? So now let's think about what is a photo. It's quite simple, you know, it's all about light. Now, what is a photograph? Well, it's an image that is created with the help of light. Of course, without light, you cannot create a photograph. So now, when you are taking a photograph, we were speaking about like what makes it better. There are a few things that you have to keep in mind, like image and its quality. So if you look at the quality, you know, it's is it the brightness or darkness? Well, up to a certain extent, it can give a better feel, but I don't think a photograph is going to be great or of good quality because of its brightness. Okay, so some people like it a bit dark, some people like it very bright. That's a personal choice, so you cannot say that everyone likes it the same way. Because some people look at the details, some photographers, like for me especially, when I take a photograph, I look at the details. So if it is overexposure, if it is too much bright, you're losing the details. So then the problem is, like, people like me, we don't like pictures that are too bright, but there are a lot of people like who wants it to be very bright. Okay, now clarity. Now what is clarity? It's all about the sharpness of the image. When I say sharpness, it's not that if it is not sharp, it's a bad quality, because The entire image need not be sharp, but the subject or the object need to be very sharp. Now let us look at a few photographs to understand it better. If you look at this image, it's dark. But then some people like it this way, but still I would say it is a little more darker. Now if you look at this, this is too bright. Maybe some people would like it this way. But you can still make it better if it's properly distributed, or like if it's balanced. That is very important. I was speaking about creativity. So when you speak about creativity, it can be different aspects, you know. It can be your thought process, like how you view things or like how you make things happen. Now if you look at this one, again it's mainly making use of the settings and whatever you have with you to get photographs like this. It's again thought process plus your understanding of your cameras. Okay, so it's creativity is something which it's a blend of a lot of things. It need not be just your thinking in terms of the picture, but including, I mean, like when you say about picture, it includes framing, the lighting, a lot of aspects are there. Okay, and even the way you put things across. Here you can see a person doing some tailoring work, and it's taken through the mirror. So how you look at it, the perspectives through which you see. Maybe a person who is a photographer normally takes it directly. Like when a person is stitching something, you'll take the photograph directly. But then again, like you make it slightly different by using a mirror, like through the mirror you are seeing that. So creativity is all about thinking process and how you perceive it, how you think about the colors and stuff like that. A lot of aspects are there. I'm not going to get into the details of it. Now we are speaking about the quality, right? Now if you look at this, what's the problem here? This is something which you often come across, right? This is not so clear. So we are speaking about the clarity, right? If you look at this, normally it looks fine, but when you get into the details, then you are losing the quality, right? So now if you look at this, I'll just give you an example. So if you notice this picture, you are having problems with quality. I don't know how many of you are able to make out this difference. The same thing. Now this is taken in a different camera, so you can find out the difference. So if you are able to make out what is quality with this, you are better. Otherwise, I'll have to explain about what's the difference. So if you notice all this, there's a lot of problems with the quality. But if you look at this one, the quality is good enough. I was saying that it's about sharpness. If you notice this, you have the face sharp, but at the same time background is blurred. So that doesn't mean that if it is not sharp, the picture is bad. What I meant is the subject has to be sharp, and that is what makes a quality. So here if you notice, all this background is blurred, but the person, that subject, is sharp, right? Now, what is this sharpness and things like that? So let me take you through a small video. So here, if you notice this letter A, if you notice the edges, the sides, it's quite sharp. The lines are straight. But let me zoom into it. So if you zoom it, then you will start to notice the difference. It's not as sharp as you thought. You can see that there are a lot of, it's all made of small dots, right? And there's a gap in between, right? So this is what quality is all about. So when you look at it in a small size, you'll find the edges to be sharp. So any picture, if you take, it's made of tiny dots. So these tiny dots are normally known as pixels, that is picture elements. So any image you take digitally when it is done, it's all about dots. That is why when you take printouts, you normally speak in terms of DPI, dots per inch. So the more number of dots in a specific area will make a better quality. If the number of dots, if it is less, then obviously the quality will be very low. So the video that I have shown, the letter A, if I use more number of dots and if I try to reduce that gap in between, then it will be more sharp and crisp. So that is why normally when you speak about cameras, you'll speak in terms of pixels, right? I'm pretty much sure everyone would have heard about megapixels. That's a common term used. So if you're using cameras, then one thing that you have to keep in mind in terms of quality, it's actually that is not what gives the exact that determines the quality, because there are a lot of other factors as well. But pixels is something which is very important, because no matter what you do, if the pixel number is less, then the quality is going to be lesser because of the gaps in between. Now, when you increase the pixel size, what you have to keep in mind is your file size is going to be larger. When I say file size, it's not about the size of the picture, but the file. So that means when you save your files, if you have higher megapixels, your file size will be too large. So for example, if you take a normal, maybe in your mobile phones, if you take, you might get file size when you take, it'll be around 3 MB or something. In case if you're using higher end cameras, normally like you'll end up with photos in the range of around 10 MB to 20 MB to 25 MB and all. So that will actually increase your file size. So that is something which you have to keep in mind. Often you might be wondering why you need to have different types of cameras. Most of you are using mobile phones, and at the same time you'll be making use of DSLRs if you have any. Now let's try to find out like what are the different types of cameras. Basically it is categorized as film cameras and film cameras, as you know, like I don't know how many of you have even seen it. Those cameras use films, actually film strips, to capture the images. So this is a film camera, and you'll be loading films into this film strips, and you'll be taking photographs with the help of film strips. Now this is a pretty old technology. It has evolved into digital. So what's a digital camera? There are plenty of types of cameras. Normally you have the DSLRs, and to a great extent most of you will be making use of your cell phones. Well, so these days cell phone is very popular, and almost all the cell phones come out with a camera. Let's get into more details about how you make use of, I mean better use of your mobile phones to take better photographs. So in this module, I'll be taking you through different aspects of mobile photography. Okay, and in the later stages, we'll get more into more details about something which is better than that. So cell phone is something which all of you have. Now, before taking photographs, I don't know how many of you have gone through the settings in your mobile. That is something which is very important, because when you take photographs, by even without knowing anything, you're pretty sure that you'll be taking the photographs, you'll be getting a pretty good decent image. But then you can make it better if you go through the settings, because there are a lot of settings which will make it better. Most of you might have worked on Beautify and things like that. That is more of editing, but while taking the picture itself, we can still get a better photograph. So that is what we'll be looking at. Well, let me take you through the settings of your mobile. That is very important. Now, all you have to do is just click on the photo, I mean the camera mode. Once you open the camera, you will have a few settings that either three dots or three lines, you go to that. Well, when you go for the settings, you don't have to worry much about these things, but there are a few things that you have to keep in mind. One is the picture quality. So most probably when you buy the cell phone, there'll be a default setting, but you can get into the settings and check it whether it is of high quality or not, because your quality is going to get affected. Now, if you feel that the quality has to be better, then you have to make sure that your quality is high. But at the same time, at times you might run short of storage space, and beyond the picture quality, you want certain things to be captured. In that case, you can reduce the quality, you can go to low, wherein you can get more pictures in less space. Then the other things are like exposure settings. So your image exposure, the brightness is going to get affected due to this. So if your mobile phone has this option, you can change the exposure settings. So it can be based on the frame average or based on the center area or the spot at which you are focusing. So you can change those settings and get your exposure correct. Then contrast is something, again, it's based on your taste. So if you are a person who likes higher contrast, then you can change the contrast to high, or you have different levels. So based on your likes, you can change it. Same thing is with saturation. So if you want your colors to be vibrant, you can go for high contrast, or if you don't like too much of colors, so if you want to reduce the color, then you can change the saturation to the lowest. Then sharpness is again like based on, all these things are based on your likes. So if you feel that you want your pictures to be more sharper, then you can change this. But that doesn't mean that if the image is shaky, it's going to be sharp. So please keep bear that in mind. And these are the main settings that you'll be working on. Now, there is one thing that is manual. So if you go to a manual setting, you have few options available here. One is the auto balance. So you can change the white balance using this option. So normally it will be in auto, but if you want to get a particular color tone, then you can change it, or if you want to make your images look natural, you can change it. Now in sunlight when you are taking, and if you use a tungsten, then you can see it became more bluish in nature. So this is not the right setting, but if you want this kind of a tone, you can try that, but it's not going to be natural. So based on the color temperature that is available, you can make the necessary changes. So if you're using CFLs, you can use this tube light option, or if you're taking in the shade, you can in the daytime, you can use this. So whichever you feel is ideal for you, you can make the changes, but otherwise it's always better to keep it in auto. So usually auto will work fine, but if you're very particular, you can make these changes. Then ISO, this is something which will make your pictures brighter or darker other than the light. So if you increase your ISO, the image is going to be brighter, and if you reduce it, it's going to be darker, right? So if you want to make use of this, you can try this. Normally when you take a picture, you can even adjust the brightness other than the ISO. So that is like even in the auto mode, you can adjust the brightness. So once you make your frame, normally this is how you focus. So you tap on the area that you need to focus, and you can make the frame by moving the camera closer or farther away from the subject. So once you focus on any area, if you notice, the brightness will change based on where you are clicking. So that is based on the setting of the metering mode. So if you are trying to focus over here, then you can see this image became darker. So you have to make sure, if you want to get the correct exposure, you focus on the subject and then click the picture. Now still you can reduce or increase the brightness by just clicking and dragging upwards or downwards. So you can see the picture is getting brighter. You can reduce it like this. This is how you increase the brightness or reduce the brightness. So for focusing, that is very important. Touch on the area where you want to focus. This is something which I believe almost all of you will be knowing already. Usually, like when you want to take the photographs, you have two options. One is the portrait mode. So when you are taking a photograph, this is how you normally take. But then again, it depends on the subject. You need not always take like this, because if you notice here, this much area is waste. So in such instances where your image is like, if your subject is more wide, you can take it like this. And to avoid rest of the things around, you can go closer. Or if you want more of the sides, you can move your camera away from the subject. So this is how you frame it. So if you go closer, the subject will become full in your image. If you go far away, it will become smaller and more area will be covered. And one thing you have to keep in mind is a minimum focus distance, because if you go very close to the subject, it is not going to focus, because it requires a minimum area to focus. So here, if you notice, this area is focused because it is far away from the sensor. But if you try to focus on this, usually it may not happen in most of the cameras, but if your camera is good enough, it might focus. It needs to have a macro option or a macro lens to get the pictures shot so close to the subject. Otherwise, it won't focus. If you notice here, it's not even focusing. It's very difficult. So you have to take it far away from the subject and try to focus on it. So minimum area is what you have to keep in mind from the subject to the sensor. Now, if you try to, you know, if you are trying to be away from the subject instead of taking your camera closer to the subject, if you try to cover the subject properly, you can even try to zoom in like this. So you don't have to take your camera closer to the subject, but keep in mind, you are going to lose the quality of the picture. So try to avoid zooming in like this. If you want to take any photograph, take your camera closer to the subject if you want to cover the frame, right? So don't try to zoom in like this. This, if you want, you can do even in post-production. This is going to deteriorate the quality. If you notice here, you can see that the quality is very bad. So never try to do this unless it is very much required. Well, I have taken you through a few of the features that is available in my cell phone. But that's not the case with all the cell phones in the market. There are n number of models that is available, and the features and the settings will vary depending on the model. So if you are making use of mobiles to take photographs, the first thing that you have to do is go through the menu, get into the settings, find out what features are available, and try to make use of it. Because right now what I have covered is very few, like the white balance and the how you change the brightness and stuff like that, even the ISOs and stuff. But there are things like the aperture, which I'll be covering in the DSLR part of it, which once you will come to know about those things, and if those features are available in your mobile phones, then you can make use of it. Most importantly, get into the settings and find out how it works if you can, or wait for the session where I'll be covering up those features, but not of the mobile phones, but of DSLR. So you can apply the same method if it is available in your mobile phone. And there are certain things that you have to keep in mind. One thing is light. Initially itself, I told you that light is going to be very crucial. And if there's less light, it will be dark. If it is more light, it will be too bright. So light is something that you have to keep in mind. So whenever you are taking photographs, you have to see the source of light, from where it is coming. So it's not just that the subject is properly exposed to light, But at the same time, you have to think about the background also. So if you are placing a subject in front of a bright area, that is like if the sunlight is from behind, or like there is a bright building behind, and if you are making that person stand in front of the building, and if the person is in the dark, then obviously you'll have a big issue that at times you might end up with something like a silhouette. So you can notice here, so you are going to end up with something like this. So make sure that when you are taking photographs that there is proper light on your subject. But in case if you want a picture to be taken like this, that you want the picture to be, I mean the subject to be dark, then of course you can try that. That's a different way of doing it. But if you want to get everything correct, then make sure that there is proper light on the subject as well. All you can do is you'll have to turn to the other side so that the light will fall. Suppose in this situation, if you want the person to be exposed correctly, you can go to the other side. So the light will fall on the subject and background, there'll be no much of light. So there'll be a proper light on the subject. But of course, you are going to lose this backdrop. Otherwise, what you can do is you can make use of the flash. So if you are using a flash, that flash will light the subject properly. But again, you have to keep in mind the distance, because if you are standing so far away from your subject, then the flash is not going to reach. So you have to be very close to the subject. Most of the mobile phones, the flash is not so powerful. So the distance that is going to get covered is very less. So that is something which you have to keep in mind. So if you look at the settings, like whenever you use your mobile, in this itself you'll find there's a flash mode. So if you click on that, you have the off option, the auto option, and the on option. So if you keep it on, then throughout the flash is going to be on. But if you don't want that, you can put it in auto. So if the camera feels that there's not enough light, then it will fire the flash. Otherwise it won't fire. So if you keep it off, sometimes you will feel no matter what, I don't want the flash to fire, then you can keep it off. So these are three settings that you have in terms of flash. So you can go for auto or manual. Now coming to shakes, most of the times when you take photographs, this is what you're going to face. So I'll just show you a photograph initially which I had taken, I mean I had shown. So if you notice this photograph, the main issue was the shake. So because of this shake, you can see this blur. So the blur can be of for two reasons. One is if the focus is not correct, or if there is a shake. So if you want to avoid blurry images, one thing is make sure that your focus is correct, or next thing is your hand is proper or your mobile is not shaking. So if there is any shake, then you are going to end with a blurry image. This need not be the shake in terms of your mobile. Even the person, if they'll move, then you'll have issues with these blurry images. So that is because of the low shutter speed, which I'll cover in the next module. Well, shake is something which you have to keep in mind, and if you feel that you are not able to hold it properly, or if your hands are not so firm, then what you have to do is you have to make sure that you use a tripod. So tripod is very important to avoid shakes. So it's not necessary that you need to use tripod always, but if you are not having a tripod with you can even make use of any objects, like for example a table or a stool or whatever it is. You can just fix the camera on that and you can take the photograph. Now coming to the accessories, you have different types of accessories. That is, like, if in case if you are making use of your mobile phones, normally you'll have different types of lenses available these days. So they are the wide lens, then you have the macro lens, then you have the tele lens. So if you have these lenses available, or if you want to purchase, you can go for it. What these lenses do is, like, if you have a wide lens, it will cover more area. Normally when you are taking a photograph in your mobile, there's a limitation. But if you want to cover more area, suppose if you are in a room and you feel that you need a little more of space to be covered, because like Normally what you do is if you want more area to be covered, you'll go behind. But if it's in a room, you cannot go behind because by the time you'll reach the wall, beyond that you cannot go. So you have to have a better wide lens to make sure that more area is covered. So in that case, you'll be using a wide lens. So these lenses are available. If you want, you can purchase it. Then you have the macro lens. Sometime back, I was telling that when you go closer to the object, it is going to be blurred because there's a minimal focus distance that is required. So the more you go closer, the more blur it is going to become, because it cannot focus closer objects. So that is where macro lenses comes into picture. So these macro lenses will allow you to go very close to the subject. Suppose if you want to shoot like the size also, if you want to shoot an ant, if you use a normal mobile phone, what is going to happen is it's going to be first of all very small. Then the more you go closer to make it bigger, it's not going to happen because it's not going to focus. So that is when you need a macro lens. Then telelens is something when you want to zoom in. Now, I was telling, if you try to zoom in with your touch screen by pinching it, what is going to happen is you're going to lose a quality. That is mainly because it's a digital zoom. You need an optical zoom to get a proper quality, no matter what, how much you zoom. But again, the zoom area depends on how much tele you will get in your lens. So if you have a tele lens, based on the settings or based on the focal length, you can actually go closer to the subject. So if you have a proper tele lens, you don't need to go closer to the subject, but from where you are standing itself, you can zoom in. So that is the reason why you use a tele lens. Now, selfie stick. This is something which most of you must be aware of. This is normally used to take. So selfie stick is something which all of you must be knowing very well. And it helps you take your own photographs. So if you're holding it very close to you, then, you know, at times some of the cameras may not focus properly. Or else, like, if there are more people, you won't be able to take them together. So that is where you require a selfie stick. So it'll be an extended one, so you can just hold it, and from far the camera will be far away from you, so that area that is covered will be more. So that is why you use a selfie stick. Now you might be asking, which is the best camera phone? Well, I would suggest, if photography is something a passion for you, then better not to go for a cell phone camera, but invest on a camera itself, because there's advantages and disadvantages. Because if you're using a cell phone, the advantage is, like, you can carry it everywhere at any point in time, because it's a daily use thing. So any point in time you want to take a photograph, immediately you can take one. At the same time, if you're using a camera as such, then you have to carry it along with you always. Otherwise, at times you won't be able to take the photographs. So that way, camera is fine. I mean, cell phone is fine, but there are limitations in terms of the quality, in terms of the flexibility, that once you know about DSLRs, you'll get a better idea. So until then, if you are looking for a better phone with a really good camera, I would suggest you go through different aspects, because every phone has different settings and the available features are different. So you should know what you are looking for exactly. So you have to go through the features and then find out which is best for you. In that case, any mobile phone with a good camera, because these days cell phones come with even multiple cameras. So there are even phones with different lenses as well, in terms of the area that you can cover. There are wide, then you have the portrait, and then you have the tele lenses, all separate. So you don't have to change the lenses. Instead of buying lenses, you can make use of the same phone and get different ones in the same phone itself. So that way you have different features. So these features you have to keep in mind, and then think about which one you have to go for, whether you want to go for multiple cameras with different focal lengths. Then pixel, that is very important, like how great your picture it's going to be. The sensors, sensor quality is something which you may not be able to make out unless with experience or with someone else's reviews. So maybe you can go through the details that is available over the internet to find out which is the best phone that you can go for in terms of if you want to take photographs, if you are very serious about it. Then the file format is something which very rarely they'll allow you. There's something called raw image which will have more details in it. So if there is any camera, I mean any mobile phone that supports that kind of a file format, you can go for it. Otherwise you don't have to worry much about it. So with that, I conclude today's session. We'll get to know more about DSLRs and how it works in the next sessions. Thank you.